get started. Thank you so much for coming out. So welcome to the inaugural lecture for the Archives and NCBS monthly talk series. I'm absolutely thrilled to see so many of you on a Tuesday afternoon. I wouldn't have done this, so I'm especially pleased. For some of you who don't know, we do have an archive coming up at NCBS. It will be open in the late summer. It's an institutional archive, but it's also a collecting archive. We hope to be, at some point, a nodal center for looking at the history of biology in India. How far back, we don't quite know. Depends on how willing people are in giving us material. But that's generally the direction in which we're trying to set this up. A couple of people had asked me, you know, when they saw this talk about, you know, why is NCBS hosting a talk on what is history in Bangalore? Or why is the archives doing it? And so just want to give you a sense. The archives, at least the way we see it, we see it as an ecosystem for different communities that sort of coexist but don't necessarily talk to each other. So we hope it's a space for sciences, the history, the storytellers, the broader public to come together and get a sense of the histories of the work that they carry out or the things that they work on a day-to-day basis. If nothing else, I just want you to remember one phrase that I keep trying to tell the students who work with me. The archives are there, of course, to preserve history, but we see ourselves as a space that sparks a diversity of stories more than anything else. And everything that we do is in service of that one statement. So without further ado, I'm absolutely thrilled to introduce you Seema Mundoli. Seema began her career in human resources in the corporate sector. She later moved to work with different NGOs involved in conservation and advocacy on issues of mining, land, and forest rights, and education with a focus on tribal areas in the Eastern Ghats. More recently, she has become interested in looking at the social and ecological interaction around urban green spaces, especially in the current phase of increasing urbanization that the Indian cities are witnessing, using a mix of methods, including archival research that she's talking about today. She's written a number of research papers and newspaper articles on her urban research, and I can think of no better sort of speaker and talk to open this series with something that sort of engages all of us on a day-to-day basis. So, Seema, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you, Vincent. Thank you all for being here today. And I was very happy to receive this invitation to talk. This is a good chance for me to visit the NCBS campus as well. So to start off, you see there are a lot of names on the first slide. This archival research has been a collaborative effort for the past 4 years, which has been done by Harini, who is a professor at Azim Premji University, Gita, who is right now a postdoc in Sheffield, and Manjana, who probably knows the city and its topography better than any of us. So I split the presentation into two parts. The first one will be trying to answer that question, which is tracing the history of Bangalore's water history. And the second is our experience in doing something like archival research. That is, where did we go for the material? What are the challenges that we face? So why did we even begin to do this? One of the things is that we were very curious about how this transformation in natural spaces in Bangalore. We didn't start only with water, we started with lakes, so we moved on to other kind of green spaces in Bangalore, which included the lakes, these wooded areas, those called as gurutos, and even cemeteries. We just wanted to see what does this transformation in natural spaces have to tell us about how we treat them today, and what are there any persistent ideas that were there in the past that reflect even today in the way we look at natural resources, in the way natural resources are being preserved or not. And we also wanted to see how we could possibly aid in urban planning and policy by using historical research. Importantly for us, yes, we want our research to be published in journals, in an academic audience, but we also wanted to use this as an opportunity for outreach with the people who live in the city. And the way we learned history, at least when I learned it as a kid, I had a book. I started with Indus Valley, ended with the 1947 independence, and that was it. And civics was like a separate subject entirely. So, is there another way of looking at history in the very places that we live? publications. The first is a book by Admin Anandra, which maybe possibly, and I hope many of you have read it, and I'm plugging it here. And the other, the three are publications on different that trace different aspects of the history of lakes and green spaces in Bangalore. These are two headlines that very recent ones. The first one is talking about hardly a month apart. The first one is talking about a water shortage that is going to hit Bangalore. And less than a month later, there's another, which is last week, many of you have been aware of how there was excessive rains in Bangalore. And there was a lot of urban flooding. So this seems to be a crisis that Bangalore constantly moves from. Either the cycle of drought, then we move to flooding, and then it's again drought. So these are current crises, two of the crises that we were looking at. But we also wanted to know, how did this relate? How did we come to this? How did things come to this stage in Bangalore? So is there any historical context that we can give to these changes? So what we found very broadly is that, yes, there has been a change to the hydrological landscape of the city, to the ecological landscape of the city, in terms of conversion, degradation of lakes. We have a whole list of lost lakes today. And also there is a change in perception, a perspective in how we began to view water. We sort of narratives seem to indicate that there has been a kind of devaluation of water as a resource itself. So for the purpose of this presentation, I've classified into three broad areas, and any self-respecting historian will have a heart attack at this, because we are not supposed to do such vast, take such vast timelines. But for the purpose of this presentation, I just use these three broad sweeps. So the first period is the earliest references we could find of mention of lakes in Bangalore till the period of Tipu Sultan's death in 1799. The second one is the colonial period, the colonial influence in Bangalore. And the last one, of course, is the post-independence 1947. So what I'm giving is a really broad sweep, and I was mentioning to Venkat during lunch that we have collected a whole lot of information. We still have to use that information to plug in a lot of the gaps that we have. So it's not like this is complete, it is a continuous work in progress. So any suggestions, maybe the Q&A, feedback, criticism, all are most welcome for us. So we know Bangalore was known as the city of lakes, or the Kalyan Nagara. But how did it come to such a, how did it get its name? It is in a, we know ecologically, geographically, it's in a rain shadow area. It does not have a perennial river, it does not have a Ganga or a Yamuna close by on which a civilization can flourish, it doesn't even have the Kaveri so close by. So every water body in Bangalore, the lakes that we talk about, are man-made. And they were made using the taking advantage of the ecological landscape or the topography of the area. That is essentially, Bangalore has an undulating landscape. So wherever there were depressions, the water was directed towards these depressions, and these are what formed the lakes in the city. And along with it, there were a lot of associated water bodies like ponds, and there were multiple names for these ponds. They were called as go-kattes, which were used for cattle, for washing and watering of cattle. There were these gadagundala that were used to be close to the habitations where people would use the water for washing vessels and clothes. And Kalyani, the temple tanks, as well as wells. And we normally think that a lake would have to be built by a king or a chieftain, but that's not really true. From archival records we have access, we know that a lot of these lakes were built by even commoners, like artisans, traders, and even prostitutes. So if you see a lake named Kalsulkunte, most likely it has been built with the contributions or the air or the money that has been provided by a prostitute. So it was not just the somebody with the title of a king, but even commoners have contributed to this process of making Bangalore a city of lakes. So what do we have? One of the oldest inscriptions we have to tell us about the existence of lakes in Bangalore is was found near the Agara Lake. So you know the Agara Lake is near close to the Silk Board region. The inscription is lost. So what you see there, the picture on the top, is what is called as an epigraphic inscription, which are essentially carvings on stone, metal, copper plates, or on pillars of temples. And they were found all across the Mysore region, and there was a Britisher called Lewis Wright who documented each of these in early 1900s. So he went around, he found these inscriptions, he wrote about them, translated them even. And so the stone itself is lost, but we know that there was this inscription was there. And what does this say? It says that somebody called Sirimaya had prepared the sluice gates of a lake. So in sluice gates, you will see them even now in many of the lakes. These are those two stone pillars with maybe a stone or wooden, the wood wouldn't be there now, or the stone plant on top. Some of them have beautiful carvings. And they were used to operate the amount of water that was let out from the lake into the agricultural field. So he seems to have repaired or fixed some of these sluice gates. And for that, he was given something called as a bituvata. Now, bituvata is a grant. It's a grant of a land that is given to this person because he maintains the lake. Or it also can be a share of the produce from the land that was irrigated by the lake. So clearly, he had been given, and this there are inscriptions like this across, which show reward for taking care of a lake or for maintaining a lake by a particular person. Now, I've skipped some dynasties. Like I said, apologies to historians here, but I've skipped the Cholas and the Rashtraputas and I've come to the Hoysalas. And the reason is that the Hoysala dynasty were great tank builders. So this map was created by Harini for her book, and what she had essentially done is taken a mention of any of these settlements in the Epigraphica Karnataka of Lewis Wright and marked the place on it. And then she created this map. This is just to show that during this period, 1 to 283 to 1340, these were the villages or the settlements that the Hoysalas had set up. Now, if you notice, a lot of the names end with the word Sandra, and we have many of these names in Bangalore, Lakka Sandra, Mara Sandra, Singa Sandra. So, Sandra is the Hoysala word for large water bodies. And clearly, there were a lot of tank builders. They were very, very famous tank builders. They also set up a lot of settlements. And this gives you an idea of how Bangalore itself has grown around individual settlements where there were lakes which were called as Sandra. We know Kempegowda, everybody knows Kempegowda, because that's what Bangalore is most associated with. Everything is a Kempegowda International Airport, or they have changed the station name, of course. So Kempegowda, along with the successors, also built and revived a lot, expanded many of the lakes. So some of them to name Dharmamodi, which is today's Majestic, the bus depot. Kempegowda, which is still there as a lake. Sampangi, which is the country of stadium, all that you can see left of the lake is a small water tank. So actually, it was a very large water body. And the Karanthi lake, which is today now, we've got residential areas, it's near the KR road. So after the Kempegowda, the Yerhanka Nadaprabhu dynasty was the rule of the Marathas. And the Bijapur dynasty had given Bangalore is the Jagi to Shaji, to Shivaji's father. Shivaji, in fact, spent a lot of his childhood in Bangalore. And one of the court poets gives a description of Bangalore of that time. He says that the city teemed with deep lakes, each house was graced by a well, fountains gurgled at every square, spouting a fine mist. A very different Bangalore from what we might think of today with its traffic and its pollution, etc. So clearly, this was a lake which in 1670, a city which in 1670 had a whole lot of water bodies and lakes in the city. Then we have, after the Marathas came Hyder Ali and Tipu Sultan. They too were involved in building a number of, taking care of a number of lakes. They realized the value of lakes for agriculture. But they also used lakes as a strategy in their warfare. For example, Hyder Ali, while fighting the Marathas, he used to break down the embankments of lakes, so that the invading army would not have access to water. They also poisoned the lakes. And so this was all recorded by Wilkes in one of his memoirs. It's one of the base documents we have of that period of time to see how the landscape of Bangalore looked like. So the there were four Anglo-Mysore wars that ended, the last one ended in 1799. And what the British, and that was the beginning of the colonial influence in Bangalore. And in that time, a lot of the landscape had been destroyed in these four wars. But before we go to the colonial period, just to give an idea of what the motivation of building the lake during this period is, what is the wife had built this lake because she wanted it to bring merit to 21 generations of her family. That is a long time. I don't even know if the 21 generations of the family are still there, but good, it was a very, very long-term view of it. And it was also not to benefit a particular individual and not just for humans alone. So one of the inscriptions in Kenya talks about how the lake is dedicated to a goddess and for all living beings. That included cattle, birds, and all different kinds of animals and any other living thing that was there. So we normally see land as a real estate. Now if you ask somebody, show them a dry lake, people will drool over it because it is prime real estate. But at that point of time, there was a different ethic of looking at land. It was not just a piece of land that was being granted. It was all the trees above it, the wells below it, and it was given for the purpose, for sacred use, for cultivation of paddy that could be offered as a offering to the gods. And when we talk about ideas of sustainability, so most of these inscriptions end with saying that this particular village and time is being given as long as the sun and moon shine. So we're not talking about Millennium Development Goals or 15 years or Sustainability Development Goals. We're talking about like an ethos that says that this water body is being given for centuries, till eternity. There were also punishments. So if you violated, desecrated a lake, there were some really horrifying punishments. Two of our favorite ones are to be born as worms in dung, and terrible, the husband of his own mother. I mean, that's like one of the worst, I suppose, to get. So these were the curses the people generally stayed away from trying to pollute or desecrate any of the lakes. So to sum up, what does this period really tell us? One, that there were a lot of lakes that were built. They were cared for. They seem to have been valued as a resource, and water certainly had a sacred mention of sacredness associated with it. So when we come to the colonial period, so as I said, the British had inherited a land that had been severely destroyed after the last Mysore War. So their focus was on trying to improve agriculture and to increase revenues, and for this they needed to repair a lot of the lakes. So they didn't put in a lot of effort in reviving lakes, and old documents mention how funds and grants were given, how they tried to work with the ryots or the farmers to repair lakes. And they also, to their credit, did construct some lakes, especially wells. They did quite a bit in terms of providing funds for digging of wells. This is again a map that we got from the British Library. It is it's a hand-drawn map that was prepared by the Madras Sappers and Miners, they sort of surveyed the entire region, and you can see where we are now. Devaluing gives you an extent of the kind of water bodies that are there at that period of time, and this is almost like a precursor to the Aisha map, because each one of the sections expands into a larger block, into a separate page. So you actually have details of lake names, very fine details of trees that were there, roadways, wells, etc. So this is just again to show you how the area around Bangalore was actually quite covered with water bodies. So we also have evidence about how these water bodies were used. So the British, being the British, kept extensive records. There's a lot of correspondence. So we read through the correspondence. We get an idea about the different uses of the lake. So it was used for growing paddy, ragi, floriculture, horticulture. So the Kandeva Stadium, that area, used to be a horticultural space for the Tigala community. If you talk to some of the older Tigala members, they will still say how the whole area used to be gardens, which they had cultivated. Fishing was done in the lakes, brick making, because Bangalore was growing and there was a lot of brick work that was needed. It was also sites for raising livestock and also for used by dobies for laundering clothes for the British, for the Europeans, and for the native city. There were also sacred sites. You probably know the Karaga festival, which is the largest sort of urban festival that's going on now in March 31st. And that was situated around 11 water bodies in the center of the city, including the Kandeva Stadium. It's actually even now where the whole festival begins. Then, somewhere around the the Europeans said that water in wells cannot be used for agriculture anymore because it was needed for drinking. So this directly impacted the farmers whose livelihoods and subsistence were dependent on these water bodies. So there were actual restrictions saying that, you know, wells cannot be used for agriculture purposes. Dhobi, washing clothes, began to be seen as a dirty activity. And in some of the wells, there are even records of people, them posting guards to ensure that, you know, people did not wash clothes in these lakes. There was also brick making that was happening in the center of the city. So, but they found the holes in the lake bed to be ungainly and ugly sites. So they said that they can't do brick making, and this is true for the Sampangi Lake, for example. They said you can't have brick making here because it makes the lake look ugly. There was also water was associated with a lot of epidemics and diseases. So the typhoid and cholera epidemic, so they began to see the lakes in Bangalore as one of the causes for it. In 1898, Bangalore had a very bad plague. And during that time, what happened was many people began to dump dead bodies into wells. So the reason for this was that if there was a person affected, if a family was affected by plague, and the authorities found out, they would be transferred to camps. So in order to avoid being sent to the camp, they would in the night just dump bodies into the well. So a lot of the wells were infected, and there are instances of wells being closed. There are also documents that constantly, suddenly lake, two of the favorite words that we found are malaria swamps and rank vegetation. Everything is a rank vegetation and everything is a malaria swamp. So to ensure that, to protect the local European population against this, they began to drain some of the lakes. So the Kormangla tank was one of them, which is now got the Delhi Development Research Institute, and Miller's tank, which is near Cantonment. There was also fear of flooding. Many European bungalows had been built around the Sampangi Lake, so there were concerns that the lake would flood the bungalow. So they wanted Sampangi Lake to be drained as well. There was also a prioritization for aesthetic purposes and recreation. For example, the British have said they want a part of the Sampangi Lake as a polo ground. A part of Alsu Lake was converted to a parade ground. Even the official documents began to talk about beauty. Because you have to remember that these lakes are at the same time being used by local communities for agriculture, for subsistence, for vegetable growing, etc. But the dominant narrative was of these moving towards the recreational idea of what the lakes were meant to be. There were a lot of conversions happening at that time. There were also changes to management. So traditionally, how were these lakes managed? If you look back, there would be these five people in the village, the Shams, the Gauda, who was the magistrate or the headman, the Shambhok, the Neelganti, who is the waterman, and the Toti, who is the village watchman. These are caste-based. Definitely caste-based. The Toti and the Neelganti being from the scheduled caste, and the Gauda and Shambhok from the Shudra community mostly. So these people were, so for example, if there was some work to be done on the lake. There was regular DVDing, desilting being done. So if there was any work like this to be done, they would ask every member, one member from every household to contribute labor. So this was how local common people resources were being protected at that point of time. So when the Britishers came in, they began to change this management a little. So these were hereditary positions that went from father to son. They changed this to appointing people to do this work. The idea was also to get greater control of the revenue that they get from the villages, so it became more centrally administered. So in that sense, the whatever was the management control that the local people had, and there are definitely several issues with that, because as I said, these are caste-based roles. But nevertheless, there was a local involvement in protecting the resources. They saw it as what we call as common pool resources. But with the state coming in and saying that they are going to be taking care of the resources, paying money to and employing labor to do maintenance work, this connect that people had slowly began to erode. But in parallel, there was something else that was happening, and that towards the late 1800s, and that was Bangalore began its first search for water outside the city itself. So if you were to draw a timeline, prior to the 1890s, it was Dharmapati Lake, which is now the Majestic Bus Stand, currently which is converted, and Champani, etc., that were the main sources of water for the city and the cantonment. But there was a failure of the monsoon, 1892-93, and at that time the British started to see how the population of the city was increasing, so was consumption. And there are huge figures of this, you know. And then they tried to take measures to ensure that, you know, to reduce consumption of people, starting water rationing, but it didn't work. And so they first set out to see external sources of water. The first one of this was the Hesarvatta sea, which by damming the Astavati River, which was in 7th August 1896. And but yet, early 1900, there was still water scarcity. The water even in Hesarvatta had become low. So they came up with seeing water, a temporary source of water, which is the Y Chetty Lake, the yellow Yellapa Chetty Lake, which you'll see if you're going on the road, it still exists. There's a road bifurcating it, and you can see that's the Google image of it. So this water source became a temporary supply of water for the city. But it was not enough. The city was expanding. There were more and more people coming in. So then we went to the Tippagondahalli scheme on Magadi Road. And finally, now we know we get our water from Kaveri about 100 kilometers away, at least a large part of Bangalore. So this is how the quest for Bangalore's water has taken us, from Dharmabuddhi in the center to the Hesarvatta, then Pijihalli, and finally the Kaveri, the Krishnaraj Sagar Dam. And if you have to see the revised master plan, the next source of water is going to be the Sharavati River, which is there somewhere. I don't know where we'll go from there, but yeah, clearly we've really gone a long way off. So what does the colonial period tell us about it? We know that yes, some lakes were built, many more were revived during the colonial time, but there were also changes in terms of restrictions on use, like we saw in agriculture, laundering, in fishing, etc. There were also exclusions from lakes. People were actually said you cannot go use a particular lake, like the Sampang Lake. There was also an increased preference for aesthetic and recreational uses. State control had increased, and we had also started moving away from seeing local sources of water to water sources for the city that are much further away. So this is independent India was very much the nail in the coffin for us. But this is just I'll show you the map next. But this is just to show how in the cantonment of the native city, the number of water bodies have reduced from 1885 to 2014. So we have to show it in terms of, now this is a map of 1885. The blue, of course, is the lake. The green, the dots indicate where there was tree cover, and the gray areas were the built-up area. Sorry, the green is the cultivated area. This is in 1935. You still have some of the lake, but Alsur Lake on top has been reduced. You can see that large body that is already been half. This is in 1973. Again, the city has grown massively, and this is 2014. So this is how, if you were to run it, this is how it has changed. So this, effectively, much of this conversion, a lot of it has happened post-independence. So in terms of management as well, there have been a lot of changes. When you're doing a field research, one of the biggest things we have, problems we have, is to find out who is in charge of this lake. Some will say DDMP, some will say DDA, then somebody will say LDA, then suddenly the forest department will appear, then they say, you tell me the size of the lake, it's minor irrigation. So we used to be all over the place. But the local office, the ward office, and the gram panchayat in the peri-urban areas would have no idea about the lake. They would say, ask the supervisory role. So they say, what do you supervise? We supervise that nothing happens to the lake. I mean, this is in sum the answer is to get. And they would tell us to go to somebody else. So even they, to give credit to them, they did, you know, take care of the resources. If there was some kind of an encroachment, or if there was some tree felling in the Gunduthorpe, they would immediately inform the superior. But that sense of, you know, this is a lake in my ward, this is a lake in my thing, was clearly not there. So we also know that there was a failed attempt at privatization, and ESG had filed a case against this and won it. We still have four lakes that are leased, Agara, Vengnai, and Kere, and Agawara, and Nepal. But at least we know that there won't be any more lakes that will go the privatization. And remember we talked, we are mentioning about the aesthetic and recreational preferences of the colonial times, we see that replicated even now. If you see lakes, the first idea that people have is that it has to become a park or a play area. There's very little for the original users of the lake. You know, they don't want a guy with cows wandering around in the lake when there are so many people jogging. So it's just like an eyesore for people. They cannot imagine. So it's mainly aesthetic, and that is reflected in having either gates, fencing, and even home guards who patrol and ensure that people don't enter the lake. So it's also in one way an exclusion from a certain kind of commons that people have accessed traditionally. And this, I'm not talking about right in the center of the city. For example, even now we can say Hebbal is the center of the city. So Hebbal is also had a lot of, you see a lot of blazers, etc. But the moment you landscape it, we've heard these narratives from people we interview. And they say that, you know, the moment you put a fence, I really don't feel like going, crossing the fence and going. So these are some of the things that we see are the exclusion, the aesthetic, so some of the things that are reflected from the colonial preferences even today. So, and finally we got this name Kathanagara, garbage city, very recently. So the Kalyanagara that we started off with is today now very much become like a Kathanagara, which is the garbage city that we know of, lakes are polluted, degraded. Thankfully there's a lot of effort that's going on to revive the lake. But this is in essence, you won't find a lake without a single plastic bottle not being there, dumped into it. So this is essentially the change that we have tried to trace. Something, a water source that was valued, that was sacred, that was multi-use, to mainly an aesthetic or a recreational resource that has been degraded, extensively polluted, and also conversions. So now, so what has happened with these conversions is this. There was a family that bought a raft recently in Koramangala where it rained, so that they could take their kids to school. This is flooding that has happened in the city. Or then there is the Sampangi Stadium, the Kanjava Stadium also makes headlines every time there is rain. So we have moved from something using it as a lake to it insisting that it wants to be a lake, but in a place where there is a stadium now. And of course we are suffering from have water depletion, there's a lot of water scarcity in the city. We have doomsday predictions that say that people from Bangalore will have to be moved out of the city. But then there are also others who say that if we treasured the resources that are there and we did extensive water harvesting, we could still have water to meet the city's needs. So what we are trying to look at through this research, what we are trying to argue for at least is that we need to change, go back to maybe seeing lakes as what they were a little before, that as multi-use spaces that supported livelihoods and subsistence use, and we have to see how we can supplement the water sources. Maybe we cannot supplement it entirely, but the answer lies somewhere between between evicting people from the city and having full water from within the source. But we can't go on relying, I don't know where we'll go from Sharavati further. Somebody is going to object. And also, we need, whenever we are building, we need to understand the ecological landscape of the city. Right now, when building is done or in a revised master plan, if you look at, it makes no allusion to what the city's ecology might have looked like at some point. It's a good thing that now they have moved to at least recognizing that lakes are interconnected, which is a great step from the for the BBMP to have made. But even in future planning, especially in the peri-urban areas where the growth is going to be, there needs to be a recognition that we are building on an ecological landscape and not just on some piece of land which doesn't have a history to it. So the part two, which is we have. Yeah, fine. So I can talk a little more. So our experience with archival research, I just thought, none of us in that group are historians. Two of them are ecologists, one of them has a social science background. I don't even know what to say for myself with a management degree. So we are not historians. And clearly when we started out, I started out because it looked like fun. And Harini had more purpose and clearly more direction. But it has been a very up and down kind of a ride. And since NCBS is going to be setting up its archives, I thought maybe we could just try to access, and the difficulties in doing just that. And the fun part about it is this. So what are the kind of materials we used? We of course use maps. And in some ways this is serendipity. We never knew that the map existed. We just happened to find it. So this was one map that was in 1885, which was located in the Lithic Society. So how do we trace the land use changes? So we took a high resolution image. This is the Sampangi Lake, which is the Kantarwa Stadium. Created this map showing the land use around it. Another map which was found in the International World Cultural Institute in 1935. The topography map of 1973, and then Google Earth, ever helpful Google Earth in 2014. So using this old map, enlarging it, we were able to actually trace land use around the Sampangi Lake. And you can see how it has moved from being a large water body to that little speck, and how the land use around it, the built area, etc., has changed. So maps were one of the sources. Photographs. These I have happily downloaded from the net. Please do not do it. I know you won't. But the thing is that this at least gives us an idea about what the lake looked like at that point. So these are pictures of Sampangi, somewhere maybe before the 1900s, 1920s, and how it looks today. That is the Kantarwa Stadium in the background, the corner one. This is all that is left of the Sampangi Lake from this to that. And also how this has transformed. You know, this Kantarwa Stadium turned cesspool. Bangalore brought to its knees are, I think, a headline we are going to see for a very long time if we continue building as we have. So this gives a very good idea of how the whole, particularly that lake has changed. As I mentioned, epigraphic inscription. So the picture you see in the bottom is in Begur, and you would probably know that that is where there is the first mention of the word Bengaluru. And we have taken some of the students there from the university for their practicum. And Vinay from the inscription stones of Bangalore, there's another group that's doing like great work on trying to revive these stones. He was telling us that the inscription actually, which had the name Bangalore, was once on the floor and people were walking over it. So fortunately, they realized that they've taken it and put it, but it's still out weathering the elements. Paintings were another source. So this is interesting because we know Bangalore is a garden city, but if you look at old British paintings, we clearly, it was not a garden city. It's pretty open. So there was the Lal Bagh, which you can see. But generally, the landscape of Bangalore has been an open scrub kind of a landscape. It's not a green city. The greening has happened later with the British. They mention, you know, how they went about planting trees, etc. So this kind of, at least for me, it was very interesting because I always thought of, when I came to Bangalore 10 years ago, that this was always a garden city. Clearly it wasn't. And there were pictures, painting, and evidence of how this was true. This is the major chunk of where we get our data from. Government circulars, notifications from across. So these are, it could be memos, it could be letters written between so-and-so to so-and-so. It could be reports, there are proceedings, guesses, and there are, this is the bulk of where we have got our information for our archival research from. And also personal diaries, letters, teachings of the Mysore Maharajas, Divans, travelogues of soldiers and medical professionals, soldiers who were a part of the wars or a part of the administration at the time of the colonial administration. Microfilms, my worst. I don't like microfilms. This is the worst source, but yeah, it's a good way of preserving the document. So where did we access these from? We've essentially been trawling all over for our work. We've been to the Vidhan Sabha here, which has the state archives, the Mysore archives. We went to Chennai because Madras presidency would have a bearing on how things were seen in Mysore. Then we've been to the Delhi National Archives because we knew there were some files there, and then as well as the British Museum, the India Office. Then we've also libraries and institutions in and around Bangalore, and individual collections. So there was a point at which I was literally hounding people, and they stopped responding. So you would see a document, and then you're so desperate to get it, you're mailing that person some 10, 15 times. After trying to meet them, after a point, you're like, okay, this is a nut job and I don't want to have anything to do with it. So they won't get in touch with you. But some of them have been really nice and shared a lot of the material. Facebook. There is a group called Bangalore Photos from a Bygone Era. So they post a lot of information, and then it's up to us to actually go and try and trace the origins of this. We can't obviously take what's written on Facebook, so nothing we should take. So we essentially try to find out who posted it, go to them, search, ask them for the original file. And here again, sometimes people just block you off. You know, they just don't want to have anything to do with you. And I completely understand the idea of stalking somebody on Facebook. I do it only for archival purposes. So yes, did we have archival issues? Oh, a lot. So we had to be a little careful about who was the original audience that the documents were in there. As I said, we didn't know all this. We just waltzed in and tried to look for material. But soon we began to understand that, you know, you have to be very careful about things like who commissioned the document, who were they writing it for, and also the bias of the written work. So an example of this, again, I was telling them during lunch, was that whose voices were missing from this document. So to illustrate an example, when I was doing fieldwork on lakes in Bangalore, we would constantly hear this is the evening. The people in the village or in the side would tell me, don't go on the lake bund in the evening because there is a body of a woman and a child buried on the lake bund and you will disturb it. We immediately dismissed it as superstition. Come on, these are all superstitions. But we kept hearing this in multiple sites that other people also began to tell us about it. So then our searching led us to a paper written by this lady called Isha Shah, and she mentions that she has collected oral history of Dalits. And it's very clear, right, that nobody was going to write about what the Dalit's life was at that point of time. But the people who commissioned the lakes would have been chieftains, artisans, etc. But the people who built them, whose forced labor was used, were Dalits. And since they did not have access to the written word, they recorded these through their oral history. And she writes about this in the context of camps in Karnataka. So this is what we mean, because the administrative document gives you such a neat picture. What is written sometimes often gives you a neat picture of what happened, because archives are just reporting essentially a fact that happened at that point of time. But there is also so much that we found missing from. Challenges, yes, physical access, getting permission. So the British Library, heaven to work in. In your office, you just have to land up there, give your card, you'll get 10 files, and they give you only 10 files a day, but if you make an appeal saying that you're a poor third world person and you cannot come again, they actually increase it to 20. So they give you the files, you can take pictures, you're given an individual space to sit with separate lights and three plug points. That's heaven for an archive. But it's very expensive. I mean, imagine going to London, paying a flight ticket, and having to say you better have close family if you want to do archival research in London, because you really will not be able to afford a 2-month stay. And so that's one aspect of it, expensive. The other is poor facilities. So I can't take names because this is getting recorded, but just to give an idea, like in the British Library, I told you we had this heavenly space for us. Another archive, they had one plug point for all of us. So you can imagine there are so many research scholars scrambling around, each trying to plug in for every 5 minutes. One plug point, but it was air conditioned, the archive. So that was a plug point. And this is a humid city. Then there was another archive. There was another place. my letter was just, please come in, and it was really nice. I go, I sit, I do my work for the day. There's a table, not too many plus points, but table, lots of space. I finish my work for the day, I'm feeling very pleased with myself about things that have turned out. I go to where I was there, so the Derrido, so I was staying in the WI town. And the next day I come, I'm back at the same place, I'm sitting there, suddenly four people swoop at me. So I was like, oh, so then what did I do? So then they said, Madam, in Hindi, they said, Madam, you're making the place very dusty. Give me a break. Some of the files have not been touched since 1888. They have a layer of dust. And they're telling me I'm making the place dusty. Because they were very fragile and they were falling to pieces. So I had a duty to apologize, and for the 3 weeks that I was doing after I was sitting there, I collected the dust literally with me before going, because I didn't want to be banned from it. So this is all the fun stuff. I mean, you have to sort of take it with the... So yes, the other challenge is, one is the files are very difficult to do this. We did cursive writing in school so much, these guys didn't do it. Very, very difficult to decipher some of the language that is there, the way it is written. Then you'll have brittle files. I've had files literally falling to pieces in my hand. Then missing files. You're just interested and you're reading through it, and suddenly there's one page gone, disappeared. What does it say? And then again it goes on and the rest of it, but that's just an important page. So that, and missing files, so there are these things where you put in a requisition, this person goes into the address of the archive and comes back in less than 40 seconds saying the file is not there. You want to ask them, did you really check? You came back in 40 seconds. You know, it must be there, but they say it's missing. Put in a requisition, again, maybe later and we'll see if we can get it for you. So these are all issues with it. Not everything is open for access. Some of them they still say that they won't give it to you. And limited number of files. They don't give you more than 3, 4, 10, some of them give you 30, which is good, but then they don't allow you to photograph, so you're stuck with 30 files for 4 days. So, yeah, transcribing, photocopying is also an extremely... So one of the archives is, I had wanted some photocopies, and they said, man, it take minimum 9 months. I said, you can have a kid in 9 months. Why are you telling me that I have to wait 9 months for a photocopy? But it's true, I could not, they didn't give me, it was 9 months to take a simple photocopy. So then you are left, the only choice is to transcribe. Fortunately, some of them also have a sense of humor, so I actually blurted this out and he said, madam, what can I do? So it was very sweet of him to have said it. So yeah, so essentially, the archival work has been a bit of thrill, it's been a bit of despair, but we persist with it because, one, as I said, it does help us in answer some of the questions that we've set out to ask about why are water sources today in the state that they are in? Are there any reflections from the past? Will it help us in not making the mistakes that we made in the past into the future? Shouldn't we take better care of our water resources? And in terms, like I said, about outreach, of bringing our research out to a larger group of people, we have found that archival research and using history as a hook has really worked well.
Thanks so much, Seema. Thank you so much. This is terrific. We have our work cut out in the archives at NCBS, that's for sure. We have a little bit of time to take questions from the audience. Does anybody have a question in the back?
Don't ask me historical questions. Hi. Thank you for the talk. My question is, when you speak of water body in Bangalore, we use two terms. It's either lakes or tanks, like tanky tank, for example. Through your research, do you have any sort of idea on either the lake and the word tank are used interchangeably, or was there a point after which the word tank started coming in? Is there a definition for a water body we call as a tank and we define as a lake?
So, originally these were all tanks, because a tank is more seen as a man-made water body. So this was, all the what we call lakes now are referred to as tanks in the old industry. The use of lakes has come more recently from the British times, etc. Because they see it as an enclosed kind of a water body. But largely, water bodies in Bangalore are mostly tanks. It began with a reference to tanks. We now use lakes more.
Hi,
Ben.
This is
Shoto.
Thank you for the talk. you mentioned that you mentioned that BBMP has accepted lakes are interconnected. That's interesting. What's the policy implication for that by the BBMP in the future? What would they take care of?
So, till about maybe 5, 6, 7 years ago, just to get a background to this, lakes in Bangalore were a series. They were interconnected bodies. So there would be an upstream lake and a downstream lake. Water from the upstream lake would overflow into the downstream, excess water. And in between these two, you had where the agricultural lands were, and that's where the cultivation used to happen. Now, what the implication of this for us today is that if you have a lake like Bengaluru, Vartu is that downstream of a chain of lakes. So you will have, say, 20 lakes in that chain. We have some 6 chain of lakes, Vartu series, Valchetti series, etc. So in that Vartu series, there may be 20 lakes upstream. So you cannot clean Vartu unless you have cleaned all the other lakes. So till now, whenever there was renovation or rejuvenation work, it would be focused on a particular lake, chosen for whatever reasons they may have. Like when BBMP started with the restoration of lakes, Kaikonthali being one of the first, they did the DPR, etc. Which was great. But Kaikonthali Lake, used as an example, gets sewage from Kathavanali upstream. What they're doing now is they're diverting it, which means it's going to the next lake. We're not solving the problem. So, but fortunately now in the more revised, when we look at government documents now, they talk of it as interconnected lakes. They say we have to clean the channels, we have to clean the upstream lakes, etc. So that's a change in this thing which has taken a while, but it has.
So, after understanding the correlation and pattern of the
so,
what is your next step? From here, where you want to go?
For us, we want to use this. There are many things. I mean, I want to continue the archival research happily and spend my lifetime in the archive, but clearly there are other plans. But so one is that we want to use this information to interact with government, with the public, citizen groups, etc. We want to see how we can help to change it. We know that water problems and lakes and issue are a part of the problem. And we want to use this research to try and see how we can help either government, local citizen groups, or even somebody like Seema Mundoli Foundation, who sort of work to protect the natural resources in the city. So we try to do that with our research to the limited extent we can. So we have our limitations of being a university and things like that, our own interest as a person. So the idea is that we take to the idea that every city is an ecological landscape and not just, you know, how we see it today as a residential area versus commercial area, so to bring a greater awareness that among people in general, so that they can put pressure on their ward councillors, etc., to consider it as to consider cities as an ecology and ecosystem in itself.
Yeah,
well.
What was the material used for building the tank?
So, not surely, but we have had, you mean in digging?
Actually, my question is coming from the point and take water and do certain activities. But if you just concrete around all the sites, it just
builds a barrier sort of thing.
So
just to, you know, make a point like people should practice agriculture and different sorts of activities.
So traditionally it would have been mud that was dug up, but as we know from some archival records that the wall all. So it's just, material, we have to look at a lot more and then keep it in mind when we're looking at it. But I think they would just dig the thing, use the silt for agriculture, even when they're being saved. This concretization around is more of a recent phenomenon. So, yeah, that's not really a great idea, but that's another thing that we have to always engage with the BBMP or the FDA to tell them that, you know, well, let's not do it like this, let's do it in some other way. But some things we can't fight, they will want so many.
This is regarding the interconnected. So I presume that the water flow was regulated between the different lakes. Did you come across archival material that told which lakes which how much?
In terms of quantities or?
Quantities as well as time and time.
There are some number related quantities, etc. Some lakes in Bangalore, you know, how much water was there in the lake. Like the Yelahanna city, for example, which I mentioned, which was a temporary source of water, they had done some calculations in the 1900s saying so much water was there in the lake. And if we breach the two tanks on top, which is the host quarter tank, and direct the water into the elements, then it can hold so much more. There are some calculations about how much water will be lost by transpiration. So for how many months can we expect to have water from the source? So for some lakes, but not for all. The lakes which the British were interested as a source of supply. So you'll have some numbers for Dharmabuddhi, which is the middle state, or the Karanti lake, which is a source of water supply. But not really for all the lakes.
And I think presume that the surviving lakes are all the upstream lakes?
No, not sure. There is a chain of many upstream and downstream. It is a good thing, that's why we still have so much scope to, you know, revive them together.
Thanks for a great talk. You know, I, a few years ago at Lata, there was an exhibition called Deccan Traverse. Anu and Dilip produced this narrative about how the lakes are the seepings of water that's collected up in the Deccan Plateau. Mm-hmm. And the lakes in Bangalore are actually expressions of that seepage.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's a continuous shifting of the lakes and their filling.
Mm-hmm.
And so I wonder how, whether that idea at all enters your narrative. You're talking about the lake as man-made and constructed, but it must have been, you know, because of.
So when we say constructed, they constructed in depression, which were already, and they may have scooped out the depression. But the water, and they made these depressions keeping in mind the catchment, where it's like they are saying that the water must have fallen, right? And diverted it through channels into these depressions. So two sets of lakes, the lake has been created from an already existing depression in the ground. I mean, they know from looking at the landscape at that point of time that this is where water is already collected. And this is where the water is coming from. So every lake has an inlet, an outlet. These are all very defined and marked from one lake to the other. So they were aware of the ecology as well when they built the lake. And they just used that to their advantage to divert the water into this collecting scheme. So if there's a depression, then they just dig up that much less. They don't have sand on the rocky surface or whatever, and then that's how they collected the
So this question, I think the text is maybe out of syllabus, but so it's obvious that all the lakes are connected and everything else, and it should logically come under one administrative body. But not just in Bangalore, most cities have multiple lakes, and from the irrigation department to the local administration. So how could we be given that this is our administrative structure? Would we get lakes under at least a common administrative unit? Because, you know, otherwise it's piecemeal and nothing useful can ever happen collectively or
so. Interestingly, I think the last 2 weeks ago they have now decided, there was an article in the paper said that they want to bring all the lakes under minor irrigation and so they are thinking of it. But it's not, I would say, so much the problem of who manages it as how they do it. It could be all of them doing it, but as long as they involve the local community, they take into so there are some uses that they found in the local community being river in a lake in, say, the center, closer to the center of the city, nobody asks me what I'm doing wandering around. But the more I move to the peri-urban part, instantly there will be some five people from the village who come and ask me, what are you doing here? So it's that idea that they still care about it that is definitely more what maybe we could focus on. There are advantages of centralizing it, and they're trying to do it, but we don't know how that will go. What would be the implication? Suppose a minor irrigation then has a blanket rule for all lakes, which may not work for
So you talk about exclusion and restriction. But what use do you see for lakes in these heavily urbanized areas? I recently saw a lake on one side, somebody's washing bungalows, on the other side, and they've driven the SUV into it and he's washing the SUV. And you can't imagine that's what one does in a city with a lake. And so apart from aesthetics and maybe to catch flood runoff, what use?
So we have interviewed a whole lot of people, grazers, the guys who do fish. The fishing was initially earlier done by people from the local community. Now all the lakes in Bangalore, those which where fishing is allowed, is tenable. So water, as it is saying, that these were multi-use and they can be used as multi-use. So if you want to ensure, definitely washing SUVs is a bad idea because there will be oil, etc., that goes into the lake, which could harm the washing cows. Probably a little safer, but this is where we have to make our choices depending on the water body and what we want from it. You can have a part of the lake that is separate and kept away for biodiversity to thrive. You can have a separate entrance wherever possible for grazers to come and graze. Or, like in Kaikonurhali Lake, BBMP said you can't have cattle coming in. So what did they do? They allowed the grazers to cut the grass and leave. So we have to figure out some kind of a trade-off, how is this is possible. So if you're washing the cows in the downstream of the lake, it's probably better than allowing them to wash on the downstream. So what we're essentially saying is that it is better to have it, recreation in nature is definitely important. We can have part of it. But that's not become the sole reason when you're excluding some other people who are using the lake for the... And definitely maybe over time the number of grazing people, it has gone down and probably will go down. But it shouldn't be an active exclusion. So that is what we're saying. I mean, a lake is a beautiful place because it is used for, that's how we see it actually. And it's used for many things, not just for one.
Marisha.
I have two questions.
Over what period of time did your research, like archival and NCBS, and now that you have these findings and your work with policy makers, their reaction to this research, and especially the
So, I didn't get the first part.
What
was
the
time you did your archival and interview? So, I have started from 2014. So, it's now about 4.5 years. And it's very grand to say we work with policymakers. It's not really that way. We have some connections in working with the BBMP, etc. And wherever possible, we try to engage. For example, APU does training for BBMP officers. So a couple of months ago, I've taken a session for the BBMP group. So there we try to bring in these ideas, you know, and tell them that this is one way of looking at lakes. So obviously, considering the problems they have, if I go and tell them, you know, my archival research says that, you know, this lake should be used for this, they probably ask me to kindly leave. But we have to do it as a slow process. So we're just trying to hit on it at every opportunity we get. When there's an opportunity to comment about the revised master plan, we make it a point to give our input so that it doesn't go without it. We talk to as many officials in our interactions. It could be the forest department, it could be BWSSB, and there are other subtle ways of doing it. So now we have a research project on smart cities. So we're doing interviews with officials. So that time we ask them questions like, you know, what do you see if a lake is multi-use? Sometimes the officials have been really nice. Sometimes they just can't do anything about it. This is something that has been given to them, a mandate that has been given to them. But we can only hope to slowly knock on the, you know, chip away at it. To say we are making any great impact it's completely wrong to say. We hope to do.
Just take four more questions and we can continue to the outside. So two here and two at the back there.
Yeah.
So you are just a second, and then you can.
Hi. Thank you for this presentation. It was fascinating, and I was very thrilled to learn that you used a lot of oral history to understand how local people understand their relationship to the whole body. We had done a very small project with students years ago. It's still up on Vimeo called Water Story. And it gave similar, you know, there was a wider understanding within local communities than one saw. And I found that what you were saying, just a small comment about how the city was not a garden city always, but I guess during the time of the coup, he does bring the tigalas in and the gardening community comes, and what you showed us there was not Lalbagh, it's not really, that was really the emperor, still called Lalbagh today. The original Lalbagh was raised to the ground by the British during when they killed people. So what that is the emperor's Cyprus and Rose.
Yes.
So you didn't use the Cyprus. So in that way, Tipu was the one, either is really the one who brings in the garden, and later of course you have the British now involved in the center.
Yeah, that's true.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Question maybe you partly answered it earlier when you were talking about local involvement in management of the lake. You talked about how it was much more active earlier because centralized management patterns change. Do you think that this kind of research, I've also come here to many of the areas of management, and you see the same thing, that as things have become more and more part of BBMP, the local panchayats have lesser and lesser control and lesser interest, not only in their natural resources, but their, you know, their own system, education. So do you think that this, how much do you see people now aware of their history of their local lakes? And you think that this kind of research and giving them a better understanding of their history might help active involvement in their own management of it? It might possibly do better than BTMK having to go the regulation.
So, I'm going to answer that using another example from another group. So we are, as academics, we have restricted our work to doing the research, right? But I mentioned this group called Inscriptions Stones. The people are dividing Inscriptions Stones, so Uday Kumar and etc. So what they have been doing is that they have actually, there are 27 Inscriptions Stones left in Bangalore, the 150 or so that they know. And what they've been doing is they've been going to those places and interacting with the local community. So he was mentioning a very interesting story, in fact, behind GKVK, one of the villages, where the stone is lined in the middle of garbage, and there was a local set of guys who were gambling or drinking bottles, etc. So when they went and started looking at the stone, they were very curious. The people were very curious. So these guys talked to them, called the older people in the village, and said, do you know what is written on this? It has a mention of the village from some AD, really old mention of the inscription. And since that time, they have now cleaned up the place. They're keeping the whole area away from encroachers, and they sort of reclaimed it as their own. You know, now they realize the value of that inscription. Similarly, in Begur, when I took a field student, for a field trip. It was the grazer there who told us about the inscription. Because these guys had gone there, they had got curious seeing these people come there looking at these inscriptions. And so there is a way of reviving that interest. So we try to do it by being a part of maybe a Nehru or, you know, any doing a lake walk. He has done a lot of lake walks around Sambandhi. There's definitely a way we can do it. We are definitely not doing enough of it, I feel, and we should so hopefully, it's also because of the limitations of work and interest, etc., research, or something takes priority. But yes, there definitely is a scope of, you know, getting people interested. And you see that lakes around Mangalore, citizen groups have got together to revive lakes. So we had recently a lake exhibition in Rangoli Metro, where an Urban Commons event, and we had invited people, different lake groups to come and present their work along with us. And that was chance for us to talk to them about what we are trying to do and, you know, how much they could sort of we could learn from them about their restoration work and how much they could take from us about how they should see the lake. You know, this is got an agarkal though, it's worshipped by people, there's a sacred value to it. So those.
Hi, really informative talk. Most of the talk, during your talk, you concentrated on lakes or tanks, and there was a brief mention of the river Akavati. But we know that Bangalore as a watershed, most of it drains to river Kaveri. We historically had two rivers, Akavati and Rishabhavati. Was it, of course, they have now turned into sewers, but is there any mention of how the land was managed as a watershed? Or whether any stakeholders, are there any mentions of how there was dependency on these rivers?
I remember vaguely seeing a lot of documentation on Arkavati in the National Archives, because but that was mostly related to when the whole discussion on the Hesagatta scheme was happening about the river and how it was being used by people and how much water they could tap from it. So there is, but we frankly never looked at it from that Kavati River. I'm sure there must be, but we just haven't. So Vishwavati, if you look at some old mentions, the origin of it is in the bulletin. There's a thing written there. And so if we talk to people there, they say how the landscape might have been at that point. But to short answer is, we haven't specifically looked at these two rivers.
Maybe that's another thing we can start to mind for our
thank you.
Anyone wants to ask questions? Thanks for the nice talk. My question is, so you have given a lot of information, so more than information, I would speak as awareness. So what do you suggest or think? How it can be taken to the children?
Oh, that
they have to be...
that's a very interesting question, and we're trying to... now, as a part of the district institute in APU, we're trying to work with some schools in South Bangalore, some 12 schools, not just on lake, but to look at all urban commons in the area. We would love to work with schools, common schools, any schools. So if schools have invited us for several talks, she's gone and presented. But yes, you're right, it would be a great way to catch them young, as they say. And we hope to do this with the district institute work at the
university. Okay, that seems like a really decent note to end this.